First single on the album is called Never Once. It's a song of God's faithfulness. I love writing songs about God's faithfulness. It just seems to be a theme that keeps popping up. I mean, just looking back over my life, had hard childhoods in some ways. Lost my dad 30 years ago when I was 7 years old, and even then I just knew such a measure of God's faithfulness, and I can look on every chapter of my life since then and just see the thread of God's faithfulness running through. And I know that's the same for so many people, that you just look back and you think, I didn't even get it at the time, but you were so faithful. This song actually started out, we'd been living in Atlanta for 2 years and been a great adventure. We're now moving back to England in a time of transition and just a time of trying to process all this going on. You know, what does the future hold now? These are things to be thankful for that God's done here. But this is a little uncomfortable, transition, moving across the ocean. You know, it's busy, it's crazy. And so I'm standing there, my family have gone, and it's the empty house, and no furniture even in it, just a big old echoey house. I've got my guitar, and I just start to sing out about God's faithfulness, standing on this mountaintop, looking back at all you've done, knowing that for every step you were with me. You know, I'm kneeling on this battlefield, seeing all the victories won, knowing that anything good that ever happened was your power in me, it was you, Lord. And then the chorus goes on to say, never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. Never once. No, we never walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Every step. And I hope this song will inject some hope into people who need to hear that. You know, there's so much struggle. People go through so many different types of turmoil. But those with their feet on solid ground, in other words, Jesus Christ, you can take very, very great hope in the fact that he has not left you. Even in the moments where you can't quite figure it all out, there's confusion setting in, there's like a cloud over you and you can't figure it out. There's that hope burning deep inside that God said he's never going to leave me or forsake me. And that's been my experience. And you know, I hope this song is infused with truth, but also I know it's written out of experience of walking for a couple of decades of life, knowing that God is very, very, very faithful.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country.
Why Worry? Why Worry is the series that we're in. We're in part three that we're calling Now and Then. Listen, over the past few weeks, we've talked about what Jesus has talked about as it relates to worry. If you're worried, that means you are being all consumed. It's not fear. It's not about a specific thing. It is about, I feel like everything is crumbling around me. I feel paralyzed right now. I am worried about my job, my house, my car, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, my kids, my aunt, my retirement. Everything seems to be swallowing you up and ballooning bigger than you can see past. So the issue is, worry is crippling you because of your control. You have no more control. You feel like you're lacking control over my past, my present, my future. And Jesus steps on the scene and he looks at his audience and he says to himself, man, they look worried. And in Matthew chapter 6, he gives us the remedy for worry. And at the end of his worry message, Jesus says this, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Jesus says, you're worried about what you're going to eat, your drink, you're going to wear. You're worried about your 401k, your future. You're worried about your car and your husband and that guy you're going to date or that girl you're going to date. You're worried about all those things. Jesus says, listen, redirect your devotion. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. But I think one of the problems is when we hear someone say, do not worry or don't worry, we hear, don't be responsible, you know, because I'm responsible. That's why I worry. You know, if I wasn't worried, I wouldn't be responsible. And the truth is, Jesus is saying, listen, when you worry, you're being irresponsible. The responsible people redirect their devotion to Jesus Christ every minute, every moment of every day. But you might look at Jesus and say, listen, what about tomorrow? What about tomorrow? Tomorrow is not a guarantee, Jesus. I have concerns about tomorrow. Well, today we're going to look at a story that's found in 1 Kings chapter 19. And Jesus is going to teach us about how we're not to worry about our past, our present, and even tomorrow.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Praise him, praise him for the wonders of his love. Praise God, praise God, praise God, oh, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, oh, praise him for the wonders of his love, his amazing love.
For God down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Honestly, my little girl learning to ride, I'm thankful for bike helmets for kids.
Come on, man. When we were little, it was much more dangerous than this. And we'd go down cliffs on our bikes, and we wouldn't even wear a shirt.
Can't believe we didn't wear helmets. Well, now that I'm a parent, I think much differently.
Yes, you do.
I think that's about it. Okay, honey, you ready to go? Hop, hop. Come on, you can do it. You're a big girl. Come on.
Oh, yeah, there we go. Here you go, you're doing it. Honey, are you okay? Are you all right? Can you move? Help me over here.
Whenever I see that introduction, I often think of Christmas Story, and I think of Ralphie and his little brother Randy, when Randy's trying to walk out of the house and his mother's got him all tucked up, and then he falls on the sidewalk. I'm old and you probably never watched that. But anyway, it's really cool and you should watch Christmas Story. So we're talking about worry. We're asking the big question, why worry? But you might be asking the bigger question, why worry? Paul, I got a lot of reasons to worry, right? I mean, you're telling me to redirect my devotion, but like I can do that today, but what about tomorrow? I mean, tomorrow is oftentimes the biggest challenge that I have about, you know, my bills and my mortgage and my rent and my utilities and my car payments. And I really do like that guy or I really like that girl and I really want them to notice me. And I'm worried that I might not get my chance. What if somebody else swoops in there and steals them away from me? And like, you know, we get ourselves all worried and consumed by all these things. Well, what if you worry and you're a Christian? What if you worry and you're a believer? What if you worry and you're a woman or a man of God? In 1 Kings chapter 17 and 18, we find ourselves with a true man of God. His name is Elijah. And in this story, and I'm not going to, you know, read 17, 18, and 19 of 1 Kings, but I do want you to read it later. You're going to find that there is a man of God who is a man after God's heart, and he is pursuing God with everything that he has, and he is running after the Lord, and he is doing the Lord's work. And the problem is, in 1 Kings chapter 17 and 18 and 19, he's running for God, but there are several people that are running away from God in these chapters. And to give you a little context, so we don't have to review everything, in 1 Kings and 2 Kings, we have the nation of Israel is basically being laid out. We call it kings because we're talking about the kings. And if you know anything about 1 and 2 Kings, it starts off with King Saul, and then it moves to King David, and then we end with King Solomon. And at the end of King Solomon's reign, the kingdom of Israel is separated into two kingdoms. We have the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. Like we have North Carolina and South Carolina, North Dakota, South Dakota. We have northern kingdom and southern kingdom. The northern kingdom is also referred as Israel. The southern kingdom is referred to as Judah. This is really important as we talk about 1 Kings chapter 19. So in 1 Kings chapter 19, it's going to kick off by introducing us to the king of the northern kingdom. His name is Ahab, and he is married to a really wicked lady named Jezebel, probably not somebody you want to name your future kid after. Try like Mary or Grace or, you know, Jen is a great name. Jen's a great name. I married a Jen. Anyway, but not Jezebel, if you're looking for a J. And then finally, we're going to be introduced to Elijah in chapter 19. Well, this is how the chapter begins. We're going to jump right into this. And if you have your Bible devices, turn them on. And by the way, if you missed last week or the week prior to that, you can also check us out on YouTube and you'll see the link pop up here. So 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 1 and 2. Now, Ahab told Jezebel, right? Husband and wife, husband comes home from a really historical event that happened in chapter 17 and 18. Basically, Elijah calls fire down from heaven, burns up, you know, a bull, and it basically demonstrates God's power after several months of famine. And then Elijah slaughters and kills all the prophets of Baal and Asherah. These are false gods that Ahab and his wife Jezebel had introduced to the nation of Israel. So Ahab comes home to tell his wife Jezebel everything Elijah had done and how he killed all the prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, and this is what she says. She doesn't say, "Hey, great job. Thank you for setting our nation and myself back on the right course." She doesn't say that. She says this: "May the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them." So simply, it is like one time I was pastoring and I preached a sermon and a lady literally got so mad at me, she cut out individual words out of different magazines, glued them to a piece of paper and basically mailed it to the church anonymously. And it was like, you know, "I pray that you die" type stuff. It was really creepy. I think we called the police. This is like that kind of message, right? She sends it by messenger and she basically tells Elijah, "Listen, you are going to die tomorrow and you need to know and that you're going to die tomorrow." So what do you think Elijah thinks? I mean, he is this great prophet, this great man of God. He's just seen God do all this amazing stuff. What do you think that Elijah does? Well, verse 3 tells us He was afraid and he ran for his life. He was afraid and ran for his life. You'd say, what are you worried about, Elijah? What are you concerned about? You're the man, right? I mean, God has been on your side. Elijah, look, you don't have to run away. Take inventory. Take inventory. Look, God has protected you. You know, when you spent all those months in that famine in chapter 17 of 1 Kings, God provided food for you. That actually, it's really cool. The ravens would get food for Elijah in the morning and the evening. He provided water for him. In the midst of a famine, Elijah was fed and he had nutrition. Listen, Elijah, just take inventory. God protected you. He provided for you. When you needed fire from heaven, guess what? God brought fire down from heaven. And he empowered you to speak on his behalf, not just before, like, you know, a mom and pop, but before rulers and kingdoms and nations of people. Like he has empowered you. Just take inventory. But instead, he runs away. And look where he goes. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, Elijah's in the northern kingdom. You know where Beersheba is? I mean, this is far, far, far away. I mean, he just hightails and runs. This would be like living in Pennsylvania and going to, like, you know, Texas. And you got to be thinking, like, why would you go to Texas? Everything in Texas is trying to eat you or bite you, you know? I mean, it's just, why? Same sense here. He runs away to Beersheba and he left his servant. He goes further down the rabbit trail. Now he's losing even his closest friends. He left his servant there while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. I mean, he is really trying to hide. And he came to a broom bush. He sat down under it and he prayed. Now, if you were a man of God or a woman of God and you're in this moment where, you know, someone is threatening to kill you or they don't like you, they send you, you know, death mail or, you know, those kinds of things, don't you think you would pray at this moment like, God, smite them? You know, I saw you like burn the bull in chapter 18. Can you burn her up? You know, like it'd be like one of those power prayers, like an imprecatory prayer kind of thing. This is what he prays, though. He says he prays that he might die. Like, what? I mean, this is not happening. I mean, can you really be a man or a woman of God and pray a prayer like this? Elijah does. And he says in verses 4 and 5, he said, I have had enough, Lord. Like, Lord, I'm tired. Look at the past. I've had enough. I'm worn out. I'm tired. He said, take my life. I am no better than my ancestors. I am no better. Elijah is simply looking at this and he's saying, God, I'm looking at the past. I'm worn out. I'm looking at the present. You need to take my life. I'm looking at, like, I'm going to end up just like my ancestors. They all died by the sword and I'm going to die. This lady is going to kill me. God, my past, my present, and my future, they're out of control. I can't control them anymore. Can you just take me out? And so you know what happens? Look what happens. Then he lay down under the bush and he fell asleep. All at once, an angel slaughtered Elijah. The end. There you go. Saddest story in the Bible. That is so not true. I just completely made that up. That's not what happened. So you should not believe me. This is actually what happened. It says, all at once, an angel touched him and said, get up and eat. You know, those moments in your life when you, like, you're following the Lord with your whole heart and you get off course, right? And then we think, man, I have sinned. I've fallen away from God. I've done things and said things that God cannot be happy with, right? And what do we often think? I'm going to hell. That's what we think. Like, God is going to slaughter me. God is just going to smite me right now. I am going to run into a falling tree, you know, like trees fall and I'm just going to hit them. You know, I mean, like, we think all those terrible things are going to happen. And what is happening here is a hand from heaven comes down and he touches Elijah. And then God does exactly what God has always done. He protected him, he provides for him, and he empowers him. Look at this. He says, get up and eat. God is Lord over yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He looked around and there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water, and he ate and he drank, and there he laid down again. Like God saying, take another siesta, buddy. It's going to be okay. And the angel of the Lord came back a second time and he touched him. And he said, get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you. So he got up and he ate and he drank and he was strengthened by the food. Verse 8, he traveled 40 days and he traveled 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. You know, you might be asking, like, what's so significant about Horeb? I mean, that'd be like, you know, traveling to, like, you know, Solanco. What's so significant about Solanco? The reality is Horeb was a really significant place for Jews. This is where Moses met God, on Mount Horeb. This is the place where people believed God hung out. Like, he is, if you're going to go meet God, you got to go to Horeb. And so Elijah is like, you know, I'm in trouble. What am I going to do? I'm going to look like I'm pursuing the Lord. You know, people might be asking, well, where did Elijah go? I mean, like, he did this great feat and we don't see him anymore. Oh, look, there he is. He's going to Mount Horeb. He is such a godly man. You know, you think of that verse in Matthew chapter 6, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. I mean, we can get an appearance of seeking the kingdom of God, can't we? Except for God can look through all of our, you know, facade. Elijah's not running to Mount Horeb because he's trying to pursue the Lord. He's running to Mount Horeb because he's scared. He's scared and he's hiding. He gave the appearance of righteousness, the appearance of seeking the Lord. And the Lord calls him out on it. Look what happens here. Then he went into a cave and he spent the night. And the word of the Lord comes to him and says, what are you doing here? I love that. It's like there are times when you just want to call somebody out for all their junk. This is that moment where God's just like, what are you doing here? Elijah might have responded like, well, what do you mean? What do you mean? I'm like, I'm in church. Am I supposed to be here? And the Lord is like, no, you're not. You are not supposed to be here. There was a will and there was a way that I had carved and planned out for you, Elijah, and you're running away from it, buddy. You're not supposed to be here. What are you doing here? You know, you got to think about this for a second. Has your worry ever caused you to run away? You know, that's what worry does, doesn't it? It paralyzes us. It causes us to, you know, not want to, you know, leave our homes. And then we don't want to leave our beds. And then we don't want to leave our blankets, you know, because we put them over our head and we're like, I just can't escape this. I just feel so consumed by it. And we believe that, you know, because today is uncertain, tomorrow is going to be certain. The truth of the matter is, friends, tomorrow is always uncertain because you don't know what's going to happen. There's only one person that does. And his name is not Jezebel. His name is Jesus. And the reality is that's what God reminds Elijah, this man of God, about. So God asked that question, what are you doing here? And Elijah has the nerve to respond. He says, this is verse 10, I have been very zealous for you, Lord. The Israelites have rejected your covenant. They've torn down your altars and put all the prophets to death by the sword. I am the only one left. Like, you might have forgotten this. You might not have realized it, but I'm the only one left. I mean, talk about getting cocky. And then he says, now they are trying to kill me too. You know, our Lord graciously protects us and he provides for us and he empowers us. And occasionally, he rebukes us. But he's so gracious about it. The Lord doesn't want to hurt you. He's not going to smite you. He's not going to slaughter you. He's going to talk to you. But not the way that you and I often think he talks. Look at what he says. He says, go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Verse 11. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountain apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake came fire, and the Lord was not in the fire. Oftentimes we say, man, I'm so worked up. I'm so consumed here. And listen, God, if you would just show up, you know, like reveal yourself, you know, like do something amazing, like do something great. I mean, you called fire down from heaven once. Let's do it again. You know, just drop it on Jezebel. You know, like, could you do that? Like, God, there's so many times where I just need you to appear. And this is one of those moments, like, do something amazing, can't you? We get like that, don't we? God, if you would just show up and reveal yourself, I would believe in you. I would trust you. And yet, you know where God shows up? It's not in fire. It's not in earthquakes. It's not in the wind. Look what he says. Verse 12, after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and he went out and he stood at the mountain mouth of the cave. And the voice said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" You know, I guarantee you that penetrated his heart. I guarantee you that shook him. Because I think the second time he responds to the Lord, I think there was not the cockiness of the first time. He still relays the same information. He says, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenants. They've torn down your altars and they put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left and now they are trying to kill me too." They're trying to kill me. And the Lord responds to him and says, "Go back the way you came. Go to the desert of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael king over Aram." Now, you probably not know this, but there's already a king over Aram. So Elijah is to anoint a new king who's probably going to go to war with the old king. This is going to be disastrous. You know, you can imagine he's just trying to stir up all that worry again. "I can't do that, Lord." He says, "Do it. Better yet, also go and anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, and anoint Elijah, son of Shaphath, from Abel of Menelah." So glad we don't have these names today. "To succeed you as prophet." He says, "Listen, I want you to go and anoint a king over Aram. I want you to anoint Jehu. And better yet, anoint Elijah because he's going to replace you." And it's like, man, I didn't see that one coming. I didn't know that you were going to do that. I didn't know, God, that you had a plan for tomorrow. I didn't know that you were the God of tomorrow. And Elijah, you need to know that. So get it right. You might be sitting here telling me this sob story about how you're the only one left and all the prophets are gone. But Elijah, you need to know, I am the God of yesterday, today, and the God of tomorrow. There is nothing uncertain about tomorrow for me. There's only uncertainties for you. And the distance between your uncertainties and what you know to be true is a space where you've got to choose. Are you going to trust me? Are you going to lean into me or are you going to lean into your worries? Because worry is not responsible. Redirecting your devotion to me is responsible. Listen, friends, today's worries blank out God's past faithfulness. They cause us to forget what God has done, how God protected us and he has provided for us and he's empowered us yesterday, today, and he's going to do it tomorrow. You don't have to worry about that. You don't have to be concerned about that. There has been so many times in my life where I've preached a message or prepared to preach a message and I sense the Holy Spirit coming upon me. And I've said to the Lord so many times, "I hope we can do this again." Or I've had times where I've simply said, "Lord, I'm concerned you'll never do that again for me because what you gave me was so wonderful." See, there's two different views there. One says, "I hope we do this again. I'm looking forward to doing this again. I trust we're going to do this again." And the other times I've said, "Lord, I'm not sure you're going to do that again." See, we can all have those kinds of thoughts. And the reality is, so does Elijah. And God reminds him, "Listen, I am the God of tomorrow. I'm going to provide for you. You don't have to worry. You don't have to be concerned. I'll be concerned about your tomorrow. You just live right now and do what I'm asking you to do." And so this is what happens. Jehu, the Lord tells him more of the plans. In verses 17 and 18, "Jehu will put to death any who escaped the sword from Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escaped the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to Baal and whose mouths have not kissed him." Meaning, Elijah, you thought that you were the only one left, but the reality is I've got a plan for tomorrow, and I had a plan for today, and you missed it because I had 7,000 people already sitting in reserve to support you and back you up. I had 7,000 people that did not bow their knees to Baal and did not kiss him. I have 7,000 people who still worship the one true living God. See, the truth of the matter is you think you knew all there was to know. But you don't. That's what he's saying to us. Worry oftentimes wants to tell us, you know, that what we know is all there is to know. And God often reminds us, and he's reminding us today, that your worry does not know what God knows. Your worry only knows what you think is going to happen, not what God knows for sure, not what God knows he has planned. So he calls Elijah and he calls you and I to go back, but not alone, to go back with God. To go back with God and anoint and appoint and begin to empower people the way that God has done that for him. It's like he reminded Elijah what Jesus reminds us in Matthew chapter 6 when he says, "But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you." You need to have a relationship with Jesus Christ if you're going to overcome worry. If you're going to overcome worry today, you need to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. If you're going to overcome worry tomorrow, you need to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. You need to seek after him. Not religion, not try to look religious, not look like you're going to church. I'm going to Mount Horeb. I'm doing the things to look good. No, you need to listen to the still small whisper of the Holy Spirit that's speaking to you right now that says, "Seek first my kingdom and my righteousness, and I'll take care of all those things." And when that voice comes up inside of you and says, "Well, what about tomorrow?" Listen to what Jesus says in verse 34. "Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." Simply, Jesus is saying, do what you can do today and trust God for tomorrow. Trust that God will show up tomorrow. Meaning, God, I'm going to do what I can to do today, and I'm going to see you tomorrow. I'm going to trust that you'll be there tomorrow. I'm going to trust that you're going to come and you're going to provide and you're going to restore the things that I think need to be restored, and you're going to reclaim the people that I think needs to be reclaimed. But Lord, you know what? No matter what I think, I know that you already have thought through it. I know that you've got a plan. I know that you have a will in a way that will be done. So let me ask you a question. Have you gone to places you shouldn't have gone? Have you left the northern kingdom for the southern kingdom? Have you tried to look churchy? Have you tried to look religious? And all the while, God is saying, what are you doing here? Like right now, what are you doing here? Because if you're not in a right relationship with Jesus Christ, then yeah, worry is going to consume you. So God is saying, go back. Go back. Go back to where you need to go. Because wherever worry has taken you, you don't belong there. You need to go back. You need to redirect your devotion back to Jesus Christ. You need to remember that, listen, worry will often blank out God's past faithfulness and will cause us to believe that tomorrow is uncertain. But tomorrow is not uncertain, friends. Not for those who follow Jesus Christ. We trust that he holds it in his hands. So you do what you can do today and trust that God will do what only God can do tomorrow. The truth of the matter is that God loves us. God cares about us. And he has a plan for tomorrow. So let me ask you, why worry? If God is concerned about it as much as you are, then why worry? Let me pray. Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for the truth of your word. We thank you, Lord, that even as believers, Lord, even as Christians, even as faithful followers of Jesus Christ, we can sometimes get off the wrong path and run far, far away from you. And yet, Lord, in the midst of our hell, in the midst of our despair, you meet us. You meet us right where we are, not in a giant bolt of lightning or not in, you know, earthquakes or fire, but you meet us in that still small whisper that speaks to us and says, I still love you. Do you love me? I still care about you. Do you care about me? I still treasure you. Will you treasure me? Will you redirect your devotion to me? So Jesus, I pray now that your Holy Spirit would speak to us and calm our worries And Lord, allow us to turn our devotion and direction to you, Lord. Help us to take inventory of the things you've done in the past, to remind us of the things you're going to do in the future. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's worship together.
So I search the world. Here in your love, oh, there's nothing. Oh.
a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate. Don't worry, be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy. Don't worry, be happy. I give you my phone number. When you worry, call me. I make you happy.
Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile. But don't worry, be happy. 'Cause when you worry, your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy.
Now there is this song I wrote. I hope you learned it note for note, like good little children. Don't worry,
be happy. Listen to what I say. In your life, expect some trouble, but when you worry, you make it double. But don't worry, be happy. Be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, don't worry, don't do it. Be happy.
Put a smile on your face. Don't bring everybody down like this.
Don't worry,
it will soon pass, whatever it is.
Don't worry, be happy.
I'm not worried. I'm happy.
Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy.
In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Got no place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate. Don't worry, be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy. Don't worry, be happy. I give you my phone number. When you worry, call me. I make you happy.
Don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile. But don't worry, be happy. Cause when you worry, your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy.
Now there is this song I wrote. I hope you learned it note for note, like good little children. Don't worry,
be happy.
Listen to what I say. In your life expect some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. But don't worry, be happy. Be happy now.
Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, don't worry, don't do it. Be happy.
Put a smile on your face. Don't bring everybody down like this.
Don't worry,
it will soon pass, whatever it is.
Don't worry, be happy.
I'm not worried.